Hello, I'm Niels Martin Møller from Copenhagen, from the Copenhagen Center of Geometry and Topology and Copenhagen University's Department of Mathematical Sciences, also known as GeoTop. And I'm ready to talk to you here about these so-called wedge theorems for mean curvature flows that are self-translating or in more generality, ancient flows. So let us get started. So I have listed some of the references here that we'll be using. And so as you can see, it's based on a couple of joint papers here with Francesco Chini. And the first paper here is dealing with the elliptic case. So these are really also including a compact boundary, these situations here, which I see if I can find time to comment on a little bit later. But this first here, you can say the elliptic version, where we're looking at these self-translating solitons. And then there's also the parabolic case, where you consider the ancient mean curvature flows. And so we'll go through some of all the basic stuff, but self-translators are special examples of ancient mean curvature flows. And then using these techniques and blending in many more techniques, I mean, then there's some further developments in these. You can find, for example, in the PhD thesis of Francesco here at University of Copenhagen from February 20. And you can find also now in a published version, this part where a classification is done for two-dimensional, simply connected and embedded low entropy translating solitons that are contained in slabs using some of these same methods. But anyway, yeah, basically what these methods are about, it's really, you could say, some quite simple-minded maximal principle ideas, but that will give some surprising conclusions about where in space these different objects can sit. So, but let's get started with the basic background that we'll need. So first of all, actually talk a bit about some quite well-known things for most listeners, which are these Liouville and half-space theorems. So we can even start here in just the theory of holomorphic functions. And then, from most basic complex analysis classes, you would show this classical Liouville theorem, which says that if you have a holomorphic function which is bounded, then in fact it's constant. But it's of course only if it's an entire function, so it has to be defined on all of C, then you get the conclusion. And so as you can see, I'm hinting here that it might also work in slightly higher generality, because in fact such a holomorphic function of one complex variable has a real and an imaginary part, and we can also write the domain variables as real and imaginary part, and then in fact the real and imaginary part of the function in those coordinates are then real harmonic functions on R2. So, and maybe this is slightly less known, maybe from slightly more advanced courses. I usually teach it in the partial differential equations class in Copenhagen, but you have this slightly stronger Liouville theorem that even holds on our end, that if you have a harmonic function, again, entire function defined on our end, or I just wrote R2 here, but it works on our end also. And then if it's just bounded from one side, for example, below, then in fact it's constant. Okay. And yeah, one nice proof is, for example, where you use the mean value property of your harmonic function, and then there's a trick using volumes of balls and so on that you can do. But anyway, then you can say that you can think of this this so-called half-space theorem for minimal two surfaces by Hoffman and Meeks from 1990 as a kind of nonlinear version of such a Liouville problem here. So what that says is that if you have a two-dimensional minimal surface, we'll actually get a bit to also reminding ourselves a bit more about some of these concepts, since this is a mini course. And then if you have minimal surfaces properly immersed in R3, So then they kind of be contained in a half space of three space. And so that's a special two-dimensional thing, because in three and higher dimensions, you have these higher dimensional cardinoids, which are actually contained in half spaces. Okay, they're even contained actually in what you could say a slab region, so between two hyperplanes that are parallel. So so it's a sort of a special thing for two dimensions that this works. But it's a part of the general theme that we'll be talking about. When can you have objects such as minimal surfaces confined to parts of space? So let's see. And so, yeah, so just to remind you a little bit more basically about some of these object types, then remind yourself that, yeah, so here I just wrote for the two-dimensional surface case, but pictures to have in mind something like this, that you have your the surface here, right? And so remember that, see, so at least locally we'll put have some normal here, right? And then so remember how to use this Gauss map, what's called normals new general in this talk. And let me just see, I just have to change the pen size here, but so let's try again. So I was drawing some surface here, maybe there's some kind of saddle point here, and then I have my unit normal here, it's changing, and then also known as the Gauss map, and you do this, you differentiate this one. Actually, often when you do it in the courses, you might call it N, and then Gauss map, and then you do DN, right? Anyway, and out of this comes these principal curvatures, right, which are the maximum and minimum curvature that you get by fixing the normal vector here at the point and slicing with the planes here and seeing the curves you get and taking the biggest and largest signed curvature of such curves you have there. And then one thing to remember is that there's this sign convention here, right, about the sign of the mean curvature h, for example, and all of the principal curvatures, h being the average, or actually often here we just take the sum of them. But the sign convention we use is that if you have your surface or your the curves you look at up here for the sections curving away from the normal, you know, your unit, I forgot to say up here, of course it's a unit normal. Well, so then the convention is that then the corresponding kappa is positive, right? So this then in that case also, if this maybe was a part of a sphere I'm drawing here with this convention, so then this means that the mean curvature is positive. But that's of course something that depends on your sign, right? If I flip the normal, then I get a different sign for the mean curvature. The mean curvature is defined based on the orientation, the local orientation there. Okay. And so, yeah, but also reminding here that that mean curvature being zero, that's what it means to be a minimal surface, right? So I guess I forgot to to write it here, but this is what it means to be a minimal surface. Okay. Yes. So let's see. Yes. So also just to remind you a bit about the connection, now that we're trying to make some analogies, then you can think of this analogy of the Dirichlet energy here, which has as critical point your harmonic functions on Rn or on some domain there. And you can of course think of this as being a linear version of this area of graphs. And then you can compare, right, the nonlinear version here, which this is the actually the mean curvature that you have here, this one. So let's see, this is actually the mean curvature of the graph. And so you can think of this as kind of a nonlinear version of the Laplace operator, if you want, right? But just to say that already things like the Bernstein problem, so where you know, you could think of this as being also related to these Liouville type questions, right? But it's quite different, right? Because this already says that there's non-analogies between the things, right? Because surely up here I can take, for example, as my my harmonic entire functions, right? I mean, I can find many of those. Okay, the Bernstein problem says that at least in small dimensions, if you have a solution to this one, which is a graph, then in fact it has to be linear, right? The function. Okay, so but up here, yeah, I mean, I could certainly find many harmonic functions up here which are not linear up here. Okay, so that's one of the basic example of how one should be careful to expect too strong analogies between the two things here. Okay. So let's see. Just to say a bit about why we do some of these things that we'll be doing now. I mean, why do we study some of these objects? Well, if you look in a book about surface theory, then you'll pretty soon find something like a pair of pants drawn there, and then we'll see how the authors will start connecting things with geodesic arcs and so on. And if you have something like the genus G surfaces, and then you'll see how all these books are full of people that work with this with these geodesics on them, right? So they've been highly useful for understanding the geometry of 2D surfaces. Okay. So you can say similarly, if we look at minimal surfaces, I'm just gonna, as one illustration, draw a little catenoid here. So just these are two surfaces, I guess, just with boundary then inside R3, just to have one picture of a minimal surface. But then in a similar way, you can now ask yourself if we wanted to do useful things for these, similarly to, you know, higher dimensional geodesics of a sort, then to make something that'll be useful for N manifolds, then you want to be able to find them. So then this is one motivation for using these flows in time to look for such things. I'll get a bit more to some applications also afterwards. But anyway, so let's just introduce the mean curve to flow for hypersurfaces here. So what we do is we take some abstract smooth manifold MN, and then we have some time interval. And then the mean curve to flow is a smooth one parameter family of immersions, right? So here's the time, and then over here I'll call this P, the coordinate, and M, and we do families indexed by T of immersions of M into Rn plus one. And then here's the mean curvature flow equation, you flow by mean curvature. And then you can see here that I'm doing one more thing here, which is that, well, this one gives some vector, which is an ambient vector in general. But then if I look at a point on the image here of this, then I can project on the tangent space, right? So I can project on, if I want to be very formal, right? I mean, I should write that I project on F of P comma T at that point of, it gets very formal, right? But so I project on the tangent space of this, right? And then, well, this one already is defined as minus mean curvature times the normal, that's a mean curvature vector. And so this is related to the fact that we don't care about the representation of the time slices. So you can see that if I have these families here, I could pre-compose over here my immersions with some families of different morphisms of M, and then this would not change where the image is. And it's really the image we'll be interested in when we flow. That's when we're thinking about it. Okay, so and then for some simple examples of evolutions, then I'm actually going to, well, I'll also draw a little bit here, but I meant to go also here and show you a little app, little applet. So let me see this one. So this applet is one that's been made by Carapetis, as you can see. And so here you can actually play with drawing curves and running the mean curve to flow just for 1D curves in flat R2. And so you'll discover many of these things, such as, for example, the instant smoothing properties of it. You can discover what we call the avoidance principle, right? Which is that if you have, for example, two compact things here, even surrounding each other and so on, then they cannot, if they start disjoint, then it cannot start touching at a later time. So that's the avoidance principle. You can also see, I sort of start by saying that, and you can see that you have finite time singularities of all these things. And you can even, well, the applet here works for these closed curves, and it sort of closes the curve, but you can still try if you want to draw something which is a bit like a self-translating thing, then look at maybe the top end of this thing, and now I let it go. It looks like it's self-translating on the flow. In fact, the whole thing here looks a bit like one of these ancient things, at least if I could stretch it infinitely long up to plus and minus infinity here on the y-axis, then it would look a lot like one of these paperclip solutions that we'll also talk about, which is an ancient solution. So so many of these basic properties here can be sort of illustrated and worked with in all these applets. But let's go back now to the slides here, and then talk about some simple examples of evolutions here. So if we're just drawing now, we talked a bit about curves already, but now we draw some interesting surfaces in R3. So similar to what you could see in the other slide where you had these circles showing up. Let's see, so then the sphere, in general, right, is shrinking just by homothety and becomes a point. The same is actually true for the cylinder here. So cylinder also will just shrink by homothety, round cylinder, and then vanish in a line. And then planes here, so planes just stay fixed, right? Because the mean curvature is zero, so they don't move. And then this is a good place to illustrate this fact about the reparametrizations, right? Because so even though this one doesn't move, right, there's no motion on this one, then we'll still think of it as something which is moving after we reparametrize. Okay, so you can think of this one up here as what's called a self-shrinker, right? And you can actually think of all of these three ones as self-shrinkers up to reparametrizing the time slices. So for the cylinder, right, the case is also the same, that you might think that, if you take your normal vector here, next to this point moves down here, but for it to be a self-shrinker, you actually want it to move in this direction. And this, you can see, can be done by doing a reparametrization here of the line of the surface. Okay, so this is part of the setup. Okay, so let me just see here, just to say. And so these are then some of the basic evolutions, examples of that. Okay, and similar to maybe as you saw in the little applet we played with, where if I take a curve, so yeah, and then in that case, what happens is that it becomes more and more round in the end, even though it starts out non-convex, and then it looks very round in the end before it vanishes to a point that looks very round at this stage. Okay. And so, but this is a bit in contrast, or a lot in contrast to what can happen up here. So even though here, down here, you could say that we can think already here of these circles as singularity models. And that we can also do up here, as you'll see, singularity model. Then a lot more can happen, right? Because it's not only the spheres that can happen. Let's take this example. And I'll just take it a little bit later. Because first, actually, I just wanted to point out, a bit about what has been happening in these examples, the ones we drew on the applet. Because really, even though it might look a bit like a heat equation, right? So then, in fact, the Laplacian that you evaluate, that you have on the right hand side, you evaluate that at the induced metric at the new time all the time. So it is really a quasi-linear heat equation. And then this is one way of thinking about where these finite time singularities come from. And then as you could almost see on the applet also, this avoidance principle guarantees that all compact surfaces do get singular and finite time. And that's because we can put a sphere around them, and then the sphere will shrink to a point in finite time. But then the avoidance principle says that something has to happen to the surface before that, okay, before they touch. Because they can never touch. Okay. And so, yeah, here's then a list of some of these basic properties that some of them you've seen in the applet. It decreases area, becomes in general singular and finite time, has this avoidance principle, which really is a consequence of the parabolic maximum principle. And that's where you get the finite singular time from. We also saw some of these regularizing properties. Slightly more complicated properties are that it preserves various forms of convexity and decreases also entropy. It's defined by Huskett and Colin Minicotti. And so you can actually play around and see, right, that no matter how crazy a curve you make, it eventually becomes convex and vanishes in the round point, like I was explaining. And actually, I would actually like to show one of these complicated curves that still will become convex. So let's try to do this. So we have here this, I'll try to make it quite complicated one here, and then I'll still try to make it close up. Okay. And so this is then the special two-dimensional situation that you see that it manages to still unfold, and then without ever self-intersecting again. That's of course by the avoidance principle, but also it doesn't develop any other kinds of singularities, right? So it really just continues to unfold until it becomes convex. And we can probably see it soon that it's gonna go there. Yeah, so now we almost don't believe that it can go wrong any longer. So now we get to the banana shape, should be pretty fine. And so there you go. Now it's really making its way around to the almost convex. So let's see. And here we have the convexity. Yeah, looks pretty convex. Maybe now I think it's convex. Okay. And then it'll, in the end, swing to a point and look more and more circular. So if we would blow up around the point where it vanishes into the point, you can see it looks very circular now. Okay. So yeah, so this is then the using this Karapetis app to illustrate this famous theorem by Gase and Hamilton from the 80s, that all embedded curves eventually become convex and vanish in a round point, you can see. Okay, and let's see. Now, let's see if I can get to the next slide here. So just a little bit of these broader perspectives about mean curvature flow. So actually, some of the examples we'll look at today were first seen in literature, even in this material science paper by Mullins and back in the 50s. So, and let's see. And then some of the geometric applications that have come, and you can say the mostly since the 80s here, includes, for example, Huskett's work showing that compact convex hypersurfaces flow to a round point also. So this means you have recovered the two-dimensional sort of behavior if you start with convex. You can classify then this work by Huskett and Stry and Brendel Huskett. You can classify the two convex compact hypersurfaces using this. And then there are these ideas, either the Smail conjecture. We look at the moduli space of two convex spheres and show this is path connected. So this is this work by Butzano, Hasselhoff, Herskovitz, 17, and inspired by some of Marcus's, Fernando Marcus's ideas from Ricci flow. And so now, as I was about to start before, then let's look at these famous examples of non-spherical singularities in three dimensions. So I'll take these dumbbell shaped surfaces here. Okay. And so then if you pick narrow enough neck and large enough lobes here, you can do it in such a way that this will happen, that it develops a neck pinch singularity. So it looks something like this. Okay. And so then, of course, now the idea is to rescale around here. And so you rescale in a parabolic way, respecting that it's a heat equation. Okay. So, and then what you expect to see here is a cylindrical singularity. So, okay. So yeah, and so and this does happen, and so this is then an example of non-spherical singularities in two dimensions and higher, well, two-dimensional surfaces and higher. And so you should say, though, of course, doesn't happen always, right? If I took something which was a bit like a dumbbell but still pretty close to convex, then you can imagine, and well, this also does happen, that this would then actually become almost spherical, then have a spherical singularity. Since when it becomes convex, then we know by Huskin that it becomes a spherical singularity. Okay. So sometimes it happens. Okay. And yeah, so I read this slide zoom again. So then let me now explain what we mean by solitons. Well, a lot of the examples we saw are examples of that, because what we mean is that if you move in a self-similar way, which could be like the self-shrinking solitons we saw that just shrink by homotherty, and then we have not really looked so much at these self-translating ones, although that'll be most of the rest of the course here. And then we can include even in this the minimal surfaces is the stationary solitons. And so one of the reasons one looks at these solitons is that you can use them as barriers by the avoidance principle. So if you know you have some of these easy examples, so to say, well, they could be complicated, but at least they move in easy ways. So then you can restrict where the other general solutions might be in space by the avoidance principle. Okay. And so all these are special examples of ancient solutions, which just by definition means that your solution is defined all the way back, starting from minus infinity at the time. And so let me actually also show this example you can get out of where these translators can come from. So that's if I have an immersed curve already here with curves in R2. So notice now where you have a little loop to the right side of my figure. If I release now and start the mean curve to flow, then this is going to snap off at some point. You can see here goes snap. Okay, and you can maybe see, if you think about it, that it's moving really fast there, and most of the curvature goes to infinity there. And you can maybe imagine, right, if I rescaled around that, I would see something like, look at the bottom half of this paperclip like thing, and you'd see something that's that moves that translates like this. And this is actually what you can get also from rescaling there. You get a self-translating solution, and that one we'll be looking at a lot, and that's called the Grim Reaper. This is the one that you have there. It'll come pretty soon on some more slides. Okay, so yeah, let's go back to the slides. So those are then what we call the solitons, the ones that shrink by homotherty, the ones that self-translate, move by constant speed, or are stationary. And they're all examples here, as I said already, of ancient solutions. So let's try, okay, so let's try then to talk a bit about this singular behavior, right? Because if you have bound curvatures, then they will ensure that you have a long time existence if they stay bounded. So conversely, then if the flow becomes singular, then you know that the singular metal form must blow up. So this is to say that if you have a smooth closed initial surface, right, then there's some unique mean curvature flow that starts from that closed smooth surface and then lifts up to some maximum time, and at that maximum time then the curvature will blow up. And then one can look at how the blow up happens. So And then you can divide up into these different types. If you have this bound on how the rate of blow up of a second fundamental form is, well, then in fact, you can have, you can show this, this is Hüsgen's result, that you have C infinity convergence in compact subsets to a self shrinker like the ones we saw, okay, in the examples. So the situation where this bound does not hold, so that's then called type two singularities. And this is not so well understood still, what happens there. I mean, there are some partial results, such as what I put in parentheses here, that if you have a positive mean curvature, then you know, you get self-translator as a radiobinder result by Hamilton from the 90s here. And then by Hüsgen's sinus triad from 99, then in fact, you can show that you split off a flat factor here, and then you have a convex, an actual convex translator here. So yeah, but that's really in this special case, you know, of what you call mean convex, right? Okay, and so then we can say that our general couple of goals here to discuss in this business is about classifying and obstructing which ones of these soltons or ancient flows that are singularity models can exist. And then there's a second question, which this talk is not so much about, but even though all the examples, right, construction of examples will feed into to how we think about the obstructions, which this talk or with this mini course is mostly about. Okay, and then on the other hand, of course, whenever you go and find some obstructions, then this will inform how people try to construct examples. So there's a lot of interaction between these two two branches here. Okay, but yeah. Then I'll take a small break and end this video, and then we'll continue after the next video with getting getting to the actual proofs that we're going to do.